Welcome back from that short break. We are still talking to Major General Mugisha Muntu, who is the National Coordinator of the Alliance for National Transformation. General, early this week, your party leadership introduced a roadmap, an electoral roadmap for AND. And by August 6th, you must have chosen a presidential flag bearer. But you seem to be running against no one. It seems to be a definite answer that you're the chosen party flag bearer.
Well, I really don't know. I can't assume that, to be honest with you. But for us, the most important thing is the process itself. We have to ensure that there's an open process. So that the moment there are people who want to run in this electoral process, that nobody feels that they have been suppressed, or nobody has been edged out, or nobody has been prevented from exercising their right. That's very, very important. That's why our process is elaborate, it's transparent, it will be in the open. The outcomes of it, I really can't say it's this or that. Give it time.
But if your name is the outcome, will you consider yourself, will you run for national presidency?
The moment I run and take the flag of the party, then it means there would be another process for the parties, because we are talking about cooperation or coalition. Then we'd have to go through that process, discuss with other parties, find out whether we should have one presidential candidate or have different presidential candidates. Whatever arrangements would come out of the meetings that we'd have, that's what we'd pursue. But at least one thing we know is that we'll have a flag bearer for ANT that will go into those processes for the coalition building or any nature of cooperation that we would agree upon.
Most definitely, some of the forces that will go into those processes for a coalition have strategies such as activism, strategies that were the bedrock of why you departed from the party that you helped found. How will you, who is now propagating organization and structure building, reconcile these two different ideologies?
Our belief is that we should not quarrel over strategy. That we would appreciate in a group whatever strategy they choose to take. And that's why we are really happy that there was a separation for those of us who are in FDC with FDC. So that FDC would concentrate on its own strategy, and then they would be at peace with the path they would choose to take. And those of us who are in Alliance for National Transformation, like now, from different backgrounds, some were in FDC, others were in independence, others had never been in parties, now we're out here. Our main focus is build our party infrastructure, prepare for the electoral process, having candidates in every position, except should we reach a level of understanding in the cooperation so that we would not field in areas where maybe others have. But we want to prepare ourselves, have the capability to field 100% at all levels and mobilize the necessary resources to put behind those candidates and the campaigns. So for now, that is where our main focus is. Building that capability, we think, is very, very important, because, again, we believe that for us to take power at the top, that the momentum has to be built from down, from the candidates down there. That's why we are paying a lot of focus on that. So for others who may choose and say, you know what, like a number of opposition leaders, believe that we should not even reach 2021 when General Museveni is still in power. We don't quarrel with that at all. But the moment any of the opposition groups builds this capability and is able to get General Museveni out of power, then there would be a new dispensation. Under that new dispensation, hopefully, a free, fair, open, transparent electoral process would be conducted. But if any group fails to build that capability, then General Museveni is going to be there on the ballot paper. And we must be well organized to oust him through the electoral process. That's why we concentrate on that. That's why we don't want to divide attention. So that some concentrate on the path they choose to take and we don't quarrel with them, we don't challenge them, we don't question that method. No, we want to say, concentrate on that, put in all effort, put their time, put their resources, so that you can reach the logical conclusion of what you are trying to achieve. But should you not achieve that, for us, we have to keep concentrating on the path that we have chosen to take. Amidst the difficulties, amidst the challenges, we believe that we can throw this regime through that, if this regime is still there by the time of the elections. If the group that is using, for example, defiance, we would not have succeeded in ousting the regime.
But your viewer might like to know, who are you building this capability with? Because there's a feeling when you form the Alliance for National Transformation that there's going to be a big defection from the FDC, from Parliament, and all the other national leadership joining you. But you seem to have walked out with just a few people, and so you're building from scratch.
No, first, we never intended to be a faction of FDC, never. And we have succeeded in building a totally new party with its own identity completely. Because we have got leaders from all formations, from FDC, from the movement, who are independent. We are going to focus a lot on encouraging the 42% of the population that has gotten out of the voting process. Because there's a 42%, it's a big chunk of people. Imagine 42 people out of every 100. Because we've been doing analysis. Why do we have close to half 50% of the population that is no longer engaged in the electoral process? So we're doing things in a way that we gain a big chunk of that and bring it back into the fold of the elective politics. And therefore, there are things which we do quietly, but systematically. Some of them, the result of which may be seen immediately. Some of which will be seen as we move on. I mean, like the issue of who's coming, you know, from within parliament or the local government positions. It is hardly 1 month since the law which barred them from crossing, because that law became effective on 12th of May. So it's hardly a month. So therefore, let people not be worried about that. A number of things will evolve, and when they happen, then that's when that question would be responded to. Because I'd rather not, you know, say this is going to happen or that is going to happen. Because when it happens, then people will say, okay, this is what we've been expecting, and now it has happened. I don't want to go ahead of myself. Ahead of the organization.
You seem to be shying away from whether you're going to challenge President Museveni in 2021 or not, because the feeling would be that since you departed from the FDC, where there are very many contenders, you now have a green light in the ant to openly challenge President Museveni. But you seem laid back on this.
No, I'm not laid back. I follow processes. I mean, you know, we've been building ANT for 1 year. I could have chosen to announce myself as a contender for the national presidency, but I knew the danger that was in that. One, I wanted our concentration to be on building the Alliance for National Transformation, because I believe in building institutions. And therefore, I knew that if I declared myself a candidate 1 year ago, more time would be spent on preparing myself than building the institution. And to me, I mean, we are just human beings. We are individuals. Today you are there, you are influential in politics. Tomorrow you are not. So if you don't use an opportunity like now we have, like some of us who have got the experiences and the exposure that we have had, the values that we believe in, and you work to build them within an institution, so that even when you are no longer in politics, that you have planted seeds within an institution on the basis of which good governance can grow out of that institution, like in this case a political party, for the long term, generation after generation. So it's not that I'm laid back. I know the challenges we face. Ugandan politics has been built around individuals. That's one thing we want to ensure, that we eliminate. It can't happen immediately. But we must work around the clock to ensure that we build institutions that become larger than the individuals who are within them. That's what we had hoped to do 36 years ago. General Museveni completely failed in that. And unfortunately, the moment he's out of power, the movement is going to totally disintegrate. You know, so we can't do the same mistakes which have been done by many leaders on this continent. Institutions are very, very important. And we are building ANT on the basis of the values that have brought us together, on the common objectives. And therefore, I had to ensure that we focus a lot on that. Now, time has come. We are going to go into an internal electoral process. By the grace of God, I'm the one who holds the flag. Then I start projecting myself as we project the party as well.
Don't you fear that this kind of strategy will send mixed signals? Because, for example, you seem to be very close or working very closely with the People Power and Robert Kyagulanyi, Honorable, or Bobi Wine. So, and for him, he was very open and he said, I'm challenging President Museveni, come 2021, come rain, come sunshine. Won't this send a discordant, won't this cause a bit of discomfort once the ant decides that you are our flag bearer, yet a person you've been working with for these many months is also insisting that they are going to run for the same position?
I don't see any problem at all. Why? Because we've laid the background. Because right from the beginning, we kept on briefing all the leaders on what we were about as ANT, what we intended to do, and how we intended to do it. Two, we've been many times briefed, our colleagues, for example, in People Power. We said we are comfortable with the strategy you have chosen to take. Build around that. Because as long as you all build strength, then we can bring that strength either in a form of a coalition, or even in a form of cooperation, or in any way. Because if you build strength on different fronts, real strength, and you are not fighting amongst each other, you diminish the capability of the regime. That's why we focus a lot. That's why we also focus deliberately and consciously on ensuring that there are no conflicts between us and the other opposition parties. You know, because even if we are, whether we have one candidate, it would be good that we have capabilities that we bring together. But even in the worst case scenario where you have different candidates, if you are not quarreling and you all have different capabilities and you focus those capabilities well, you can still disintegrate this regime. The most important thing is to know that this one is on this front, the other one is on that front, this one is doing that, the other one is doing that, and you are not conflicting. It is only when you quarrel that you weaken yourself and undermine the confidence of the population that is looking at you or to you or up to you, or undermining their trust. Because what we need now more than anything else is the trust of the population to look at us and say, these people are mature, we can trust them. They seem to have the capability not only to take power but to manage it better. That's what we need, because the moment we achieve that, forget about these fears that people harbor. Say, oh, General Museveni has an army, he has police, he has money, he has whatever. That just evaporates like smoke. Once a big chunk of the population reaches the conclusion to say, we can trust these people. That's what we have to work for.
General, well put. That's well put. But Ugandans, especially the elite that seem to be your ardent supporters, seem to be increasingly becoming passive in participating in governance issues. Don't you think, as politicians, especially on the opposition, you're failing them?
Why should they become passive? We're in a boat that could sink. Everybody must put their hands on the oars and we row the boat to safe ground. How can is a country like that? I don't know whether we are really in the same situation. We really are not in a very good place as a country. So I don't see why on earth anybody, more so the educated, why anybody would take a back seat.
Because probably you're today, this one is forming a new political party, the other one is bickering with the other, and it's taken what, almost 20, 25 years without the promised change coming, so they probably become fatigued.
Why would they be fatigued? You know, They don't get fatigued in doing everything humanly possible to get money. Everybody comes here in town. They don't get money on a daily basis, but they keep coming until they succeed in getting the money. So is money more important than politics? Politics is at the core of our existence as a people. Whether you are a doctor, whether you are a lawyer, whether you are a teacher, you are a farmer, wherever you are. You cannot fully exploit your opportunities in whatever field you are in if politics is in a mess. Even the issue of eating of food is impacted negatively if there is wrong politics. So how on earth can we do all other things without giving up, and we give up on politics, which is at the core of our existence?
But for each general election that we go into, voter apathy increases. Yes. Do you, as a new political party, plan to address this challenge?
Of course. That's why we keep doing all things that are possible to keep building capabilities. We cannot shy away from that. We must have the capability, for example, to have agents in all the 35,000 polling stations. If you don't have agents, who's going to cut your vote? We don't have the kind of election that you will see happening in Europe. Here, it's a battle until victory. So you must have those capabilities. You must mobilize resources. You must get good people who are able to go there and guard the vote, whom they are not going to buy, whom they are not going to compromise. Because if you don't build that capability, then you'll be cheated.
Do you wake up one time and feel like regret ever leaving a party that you fought so hard to found?
No, I've never had any regrets. Because at least we established something in FDC, and if FDC continues on the path that we established there, the internal democratic processes, they're on the, they will be on the right path, I fully participate in establishing that in FDC. And there is a record. Nobody can challenge that. Two, when we separated, because there has been some confusion of people say, oh, Muntu, you are defeated and you just run away. How democratic are you? Time is going to prove us right. Why? Because one, we're going to build internal democratic processes within ANT, first and foremost. Two, anybody who watches the kind of politics which is ongoing within the country, eventually, those who are mature enough to admit once they see whatever is happening, would recognize that now there's no internal warfare in FDC. If we had chosen to stay and fight from within, then what happened under my leadership would have continued, because we were in a state of paralysis. And that was a major opposition party. So if the major opposition party is in a state of paralysis, you are never even in news fighting, you start losing credibility in the eyes of the public, losing trust. How would anybody think that that would be fair? We are fair people. We do things after doing analysis and knowing the best thing to do at any point of time. We chose separate. We knew we would be misunderstood. We didn't bother about that. We knew that the moment we separate and we start building from scratch, and most important, don't engage in fights with FDC, we have achieved both.
General, is it
possible? So now, if FDC concentrates on the things that they need to do, they will do them without having internal strife. We never had the opportunity that at least FDC has now of, being internally harmonious and moving on the route that they are moving on. So it was not a question of losing an election, ever. It was a question of what do we do to salvage our country, which is bleeding. How do we move in a way where we can cease having internal strife within the organization? We chose the right path. And history is going to absorb us.
General, is it feasible that for every disagreement in an organization, you move on? I'll give you an example. there is a feeling right now that you're the destined flag bearer for ANT, presidential flag bearer for ANT. But if forces come up and they disagree with you on you becoming the first flag bearer for ANT, so will they have to move on and form a new political party? I don't know whether you get my
if the organization would have built internal mechanisms of resolving conflict, and if the major players are mature in the manner in which they handle those internal conflicts, you don't have to separate. Because there are parties even outside Uganda where you find different tendencies. These ones believe in this, the other ones believe in that, but they are mature enough to handle them. We are not mature enough. Even here, like in ANT, if any internal conflict arose and we are not mature enough to handle it in a mature way and remain stable, we can just separate. That can happen, you know. Some parties simply disappear. I mean, we have seen many parties on this continent completely disappear. So it is incumbent upon those of us who are in politics, whatever our beliefs are, whatever we are doing, first to know that there are certain organizational capabilities that we must have, there are certain skills that we must apply, there is a level of maturity that we must also have, and also building a new culture in the political organizations themselves. So we could have remained in FDC, definitely, if we are all mature. We could have managed those internal contradictions. But we failed. I don't blame anybody myself that it was because of this one or that one. We just simply failed to manage the internal conflicts. And here we are, separate. And I think it's the best thing that could have happened.
General, individualism versus institutional building. This seems to be a challenge that bedevils most of the organizations that are started in Uganda. How ready are you to address this?
We have to come again.
Individualism, yes, versus institutional building. Yes. This is a challenge that bedevils very many organizations in Uganda. How are you planning to address this in ANT?
Yeah, we must first admit that it is a trend in our politics that people believe in individuals more than institutions. I mean, they even call parties after the key leaders in those parties. You hear them saying, oh, this is so-and-so's party. And you have to be conscious of that. In ANT, at least we are deliberate about it. I mean, when you look, for example, at the nature of our constitution, we have got a chairperson. When we reach a point where we elect a chairperson who cannot run for the presidency of the country, cannot run for LC5, cannot run for member of parliament, his or her role would be to build a party so that it's strong enough so that all flag bearers from national level presidency to the lowest level, even LC1, that when they run on the ticket of the party, that they can go through because of the strength and the image and brand that the party would have built itself to become. That would be the role. In this particular case, for example, in my case, the moment I choose to run for flag bearer of the party, I'd have to relinquish being a national coordinator. We'd have to get another national coordinator, the interim, for the interim period, until we elect a chairperson. And that chairperson can't be me or anybody who would want to run for president of the country or member of parliament or national district LC5 or LC3, whatever. So once we do that and consistently, then we start making institutions stronger, and therefore individuals would be subordinated to the institutions. It's deliberate, but we recognize that we have that disease in this country. But we are conscious of it, and that's why we are working to ensure that we can cure it.
General, your parting shot.
Fellow Ugandans, we are going into an intense 6 months, in a very, very tricky period when we have got the COVID-19. It's a threat. Some people have died in many other countries. Fortunately, by God's grace, we have not lost people here in Uganda, and we pray that it remains so. And it has caused its own restrictive conditions by the Electoral Commission. We will engage with the Electoral Commission to see how we can all agree on the best way we can hold an election when all Ugandans have had a message from all contenders. Why? Because while we are now attracted by COVID-19, we must not forget that we have had a political pandemic for 58 years. People die. People are poor. People lack services to a level that they desire to have them in education, in health. Corruption is rife in the country. Now we have to ensure that while we watch on the measures not to spread COVID-19, that at the same time we don't let the political pandemic continue. It may seem tough, but it's something we must do in the remaining 6 months. Anybody who has got any form of influence, to influence the people where they are at, whether in the village, whether in an office, whether in a business, to ensure that we can resolve this long-standing political problem in this country. 58 years is a very long time. We must have politics of a different nature. We must introduce character in politics.
Thank you very much, General, for making time for the show. You've been watching The Checkpoint, and we've been talking to Major General Mugisha Muntu, the National Coordinator Alliance for National Transformation. Welcome to this exciting edition of The Checkpoint with me, Nicholas Wasajja. Thank you for keeping it urban. My guest tonight is a politician and a retired military officer, Major General Mugisha Muntu. Welcome to this show.
Thank you. Thank you for hosting me.
General, you are a national leader, so we are going to be discussing a wide range of issues. But first, there seems to be a feeling that politicians, especially in the opposition, have been absent in the fight against the COVID-19 pandemic.
Yeah, but we gave our support to the government, gave support to the measures by Minister of Health, and basically that was what was required. And we didn't want the government to be distracted in the effort to preserve lives. That's why we gave it unqualified support in regard to that at the beginning of the lockdown. Of course, unfortunately, along the way, they seem to have lost direction. And at that point, we started bring out open challenges, the manner in which they were managing the process, which I thought was very, very unfortunate, because in a time of crisis like we are in, that's when you would expect that those who are in government would really care more for the population than even ever. Because in a crisis, you have people who are threatened with death by a pandemic like we've been facing. Fortunately, by God's grace, we've not lost any people. And you would have expected that there would be attention to the people who had lost jobs, that there'd be attention for feeding those who are highly vulnerable. Unfortunately, when we saw actions of leaders who are now looking at more on how to take advantage of that situation and benefit, you know, like the manner in which they managed the purchase of food, recently the purchase of face masks, and then of course the distribution of food, that was absolutely unfortunate. And of course the manner in which they handled even some of the opposition leaders like Zake. You know, why would they do that? Because the biggest danger in the distribution of food was if people mass, and therefore you create a possibility of higher chances of spread when people are congregated. But if they followed the Ministry of Health regulations and people could distribute food without necessarily being the government in a manner that would not jeopardize people's lives, why on earth would you stop them? Because the government didn't have a capacity to feed everybody who was vulnerable. It was really ugly. And I think that's what made us start backtracking. And the reserved support we had given initially, we started challenging the regime. It's unfortunate the way they abused the trust the whole country had put in them.
If you had been given a platform probably to do more than just donate food aid, did you have ideas on how, what kind of measures would have been best put in place to combat the spread of COVID-19?
The measures which the Minister of Health has taken so far were good in regard to what has been done elsewhere in all other countries. And it's commendable, the health workers, the manner in which they have responded to this kind of crisis, even the measures put in place by the Minister of Health. I think that whole effort has unfortunately been undermined by leaders on the political side in the manner in which they have handled all these procurements, like I've indicated. The short landing of food, like in Kampala and Wakiso, there were 1.5 million people. By the time they started easing on the lockdown, some areas had not even received food. I think basically that was what has undermined the support, which was, you know, across the board, including the opposition, including the whole population. In that regard, it was unfortunate. We made some contributions, the different parties made some contributions in terms of what they could afford. Like in Alliance for National Transformation, we gave support to the COVID-19 and to the disaster, mostly in Kasese, because it happened at that time when we were bringing in our support. But the only difference is that we didn't put it into the National Task Force. We chose to give it to Red Cross, because Red Cross is a professional organization. It has got expertise and experience in disaster management. And we didn't want to, you know, be, you know, tangled up with, I mean, or to be mixed up with the politics of the National Task Force. That's why we chose to pass it on to Red Cross. And they distributed it quite efficiently in Kasese.
We are in a state of a partial opening up of the country's economy, but on the other hand, cases of COVID-19 are increasing. Do you think government's efforts are aggressive in combating this pandemic?
We are at a very, very tricky point. It's a dilemma. I don't think it's here in Uganda alone. I see it happening in other countries as well, in Europe, in China, in America. One would have hoped that we have a situation where we would all keep thinking and acting in concert, whether it is those in government, whether it is those in opposition, because we are talking about lives. Now, the only unfortunate thing is that in our situation, we don't have that working relationship where there is trust on both sides. The regime is of a nature that they use everything that they can to take advantage of any situation. And that's absolutely unfortunate. I wouldn't have seen any reason why they wouldn't have had constant meetings between the regime and the parties, for example, which have got leaders in parliament. They could have kept on discussing and do things in a transparent way without the regime trying to take advantage for political reasons. But the moment they took that path, then they lost our goodwill as the opposition. And when you are faced with this kind of situation, people's lives are at risk. There is a looming crisis, because if the disease was to spread further, like now it is going into communities. You don't want to go into that kind of crisis when there is accusations and counter-accusations, there are divisions on political lines, because people die, and it's not people who support one party. It's not that they support government or they support opposition. So in a situation of that nature, that's why you really need leaders, most of those who run governments, to be above politics, partisan politics, and take the moral high ground. But unfortunately, we have leaders who are incapable of taking the moral high ground, and That's unfortunate.
Everyone might desire, or any nation might desire, to have politicians that under certain circumstances view things beyond politics. But you highlight the issue of mistrust across the political divide. In your view, what causes this kind of mistrust? Because one would then think that probably if we have national leaders that are mature in the way of dealing with things, then probably they could see certain things, for example, the situation we are in a different way. But what causes this kind of mistrust?
You know, as you said, it takes two to tango. Now, mostly the direction of politics in a country is to a large extent influenced by a party in power. If a party in power chooses to take the moral high ground in a situation of a crisis, and it involves all stakeholders, and does things in a transparent way, and therefore builds trust with those who are outside government, then things work well. And most times, even those in opposition will reciprocate. And if they don't reciprocate, when the government in the party in power has done things in a transparent way, then the opposition would get exposed in a negative way. When a party in power is the one which is manipulating the situation to its advantage, then it complicates the situation.
But do you think in any way COVID-19 has affected political parties and political space in Uganda?
Absolutely. I mean, we've lost, for example, 3 months. When we were locked down in March, where, you know, at the beginning of a second tour of the whole country, we had about 17 sub-regions that we are going back into. We had just gone the first round, we had finished 21 sub-regions. We are going back in the next 45 days, we are supposed to tour 17 sub-regions, and we were locked down. So since that time, the only thing we've been doing is planning and also conducting meetings, you know, online, you know, for different things. And we had hoped that when the lockdown is lifted, that would roll out and go back to the same program. But now, because of the restrictive nature of the electoral commission program, we have skipped that period. And we now can't go down and continue with the building process. So now we are going to engage in the electoral process. So it's a destabilizing thing. But nevertheless, we'll have to do everything humanly possible to ensure that amidst all those challenges, that we move ahead to fulfill our objectives.
So do you have a strategy on a comeback after losing out on 3 months?
We have no alternative now other than to operate within the time available. But the other alternative was if there was an extension. But the nature of our constitution, by 12th May, there must be a new president has to be sworn in. The only other way you may not have that is if there is a national emergency, if there is a declaration of a state of emergency. The only person who can declare a state of emergency is a sitting president. The complication in that is when a sitting president declares a state of emergency, there are certain things that happen. Like beyond May, if there was a state of emergency and we didn't have elections by May, then the president would relinquish power. The Speaker of Parliament would have to start managing the country until an election is held. There are a number of details involved in that. And as we know, the nature of the incumbent, I don't see it in him to declare a state of emergency that would see him out of control of government, and therefore we chose not even attempt to go in that direction. And therefore we must do everything humanly possible within the time that is available to do what needs to be done to ensure that we fulfill our objectives, which is to take power.
Are you saying that as Alliance for National Transformation, you would have preferred the extension of our elections?
If it was possible, our thoughts were that there needed to be compensation for the time that had been lost. So anywhere between 3 to 6 months would have been adequate enough for parties to reorganize and then move ahead and do all things that are necessary to prepare for the election. But in spite of that disadvantage, in spite of that challenge, we still have to operate within the time that is available to ensure that we fulfill our objectives nevertheless.
When you launched the Alliance for National Transformation, you said you're going to concentrate on organization, which was the principal departing ideological difference from the FDC. How far have you gone with this strategy of organization?
To a large extent, for a young party as we are, 1 year, to have done what we have done, tour all the 21 sub-regions, establish leaderships at every sub-region level, establish leadership at every district level, and in a number of districts going down to constituency, and some districts, not so many, down to a sub-county level. That's significant. Now, we had hoped in March and April we're going to engage in a fundraising exercise from which we would channel money to the district level. So the districts would go down and establish at every parish and every sub-county. So it had been our target that by the time of election, that would be at every parish level, at every sub-county level. Now that exercise was terminated because of the lockdown. So now we're engaged in an internal elective process to get a flag bearer. Nevertheless, the effort, one, of doing fundraising, two, of ensuring that the monies that we're able to generate, that we put it down for the party to continue building from the district level down to the parish level. That one will remain continuous. We're not going to stop that, even when we are preparing to go into an electoral period.
Your strategy seems to be favoring physical contact, where you organize groups of people. But with the Electoral Commission's revised electoral roadmap, it seems you are going for a scientific election where you're supposed to communicate on online platforms and through use of media. Do you think the revised roadmap and the scientific election, quote unquote, will favor your kind of strategy?
It has quite a number of challenges. One, the physical engagements create a lot of value, more so those of us who are focusing a lot on small meetings. Our meetings would be 100 people, 150, 200 people, because we'd engage those whom we believe can wield influence in the areas where they come from, wielding influence at the parish level, at the sub-county level, at the constituency level, because those are the ones we are targeting to turn into coordinators. So when you engage with 200 people, 150 people, you speak, you talk about what you are about as an organization, there's time for the participants to ask questions, to engage. There's a lot of value in that. The moment you lose that, communication through radio, through TV, yes, has got certain advantages. You cover wider areas, but there isn't that touch, the value that comes out of close engagements. Nevertheless, we believe that that will remain on the town hall meetings. There's absolutely no reason why there should be clamped down on that. We'll keep arguing with the Electoral Commission on the issue of rallies. We'll have to make engagements with them and see what is possible, what is not possible. But on engagements, where you meet with 100 people or 50 people, 200 people, it's possible to meet in a large area like in a football field, and you create social distancing, and you have your loudspeakers, and you make an engagement. The moment that is fully clarified, we will continue doing that because we know the value that is in that. And we don't see any reason on earth why that would be clamped down upon. Yes, Rory's, there's a lot of debate ongoing. We'll wait and see how that evolves.
But there is a feeling that there is no end in sight with your organization strategy and the building of structures. And considering the fact that well, young people are fast-paced and they want instant results. What do you have to say about this?
Building is unavoidable if you want to build things which last long. It's like you have a house, and however much you want to enter it, at least you must let the cement set. You know, the foundation has to set for you to build a house if you don't want it to crack. So there are things which are unavoidable. Like now, the route we've chosen to take as ANT, as a way which we believe is the guaranteed solution to the problems that we face as a country of attracting good people into politics. How can that be avoidable? Because that's where the solution lies. Any party which is going to reverse the trend of politics in this country and put this country on the right track cannot avoid building a critical number of leaders at different levels across generations who are good, who want to do what is right, who have integrity, who have character, who are honest, who are transparent. But those are the things which bedevil us. So if you skip that, it means that it will be politics as usual. It means that you have a concentration of people who want to go into politics to advance their own self-interest. That's why we have the corruption that we have. That's why we have the impunity that we have. That's why we have the nepotism that we have. That's why we have injustices that we have. There are no shortcuts. And we can't be diverted by whoever wants shortcuts. We are not stopping anybody. Let them take shortcuts. We will not take shortcuts because we want to be a solution to the challenges of this country, not just taking power. Because taking power is a routine. It happens all the time, all over the world. But why is it that there are a number of countries where people have changed governments many times, but the politics remains the same? The injustices remain. Poverty is increasing. Why? You must change the nature of politics. And you cannot let the crooks who have made politics become the way it is remain there in the majority, and then you think that you are going to have something different. It's just not possible. If they are crooks, you'll get crooked politics. The only way you can have politics straightened out is you get straight people in politics. You get honest people, people of integrity, people of character, men and women, old and young. They become a concentration. And then they build a society that they are proud of. There are no shortcuts.
General, there is consensus within forces of change that there is need to be unity, especially within opposition parties, and that it is the only way to defeat the sitting regime. But you seem to be absent in these conversations. For instance, recently a platform was launched between People Power and the People's Government, but you were in issue.
Yeah, we were invited, and we responded to our colleagues and said, look, we have a very short time in which we have to build ourselves and strengthen ourselves as a young party. So we've taken 1 year concentrating on building ourselves grassroots up. Also, making ourselves attractive to attract good leaders who will become candidates on the party ticket. So we said we are not people who want to divide attention and fight on two different fronts. Because whenever we engage in anything, we put there our all, our time, our effort, our resources. And therefore we said, for now, you guys, you can go ahead, because many of them may be better prepared than we are. For us, our focus has to be on one front, and that front is to prepare ourselves and run this regime out of power through an electoral process. Whatever anybody may think, because there are people who think that's an impossible task, that is the way they think, that's legitimate for them, we think we can. And therefore we'll not spare any effort in terms of time, in terms of resources, to concentrate it in that area. The colleagues who have got enough time to operate on different fronts, we told them it's legitimate, go ahead with that, but we'll not join you in that effort.
General, but would you support a joint candidature as we go forward?
Joint candidature, we have no problem. And it is not by accident that as we speak, ANT is not in conflict with any other political organization. We keep saying this. We are not in conflict with DP. We are not in conflict with People Power. We are not in conflict with JEMA. Even with FDC, of which we don't have any official working relationship, we are not in conflict with them. That's not by accident. It's out of conscious, deliberate actions. The way we act, the way we respond to issues between us and other organizations, is deliberate. Why? Because our view is that the strength of the coalition or the cooperation that we build would have to come from the combined strength of the different groups. So you have to concentrate on building strength within each group as we are doing. That's one. So that once you bring that strength, you combine it, then you gain more strength. Two, the stability of the coalition or cooperation at the top that would be built would be rooted in the stability of the component parts. We've been concentrating on ensuring that we are stable. So that the appropriate moment, unfortunately now because of the lockdown, we have lost a bit of time. Then we can work and see what areas can we work together on to build a coalition or cooperation, whatever we agree upon. If it requires having a joint candidate, that yes, we can have a joint candidate. But that we must have the necessary infrastructure to ensure that we're able to take power through that. We've been concentrating on that ourselves.
General, let's go for a short break.